Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Rausan Pereira. The Maldivian government on Monday acknowledged that the main opposition candidate, Ibrahim Mohamed Solih, has defeated President Abdul Gayoom in an election amid international calls for him to concede. Before the vote, Yameen's main political rivals were either in prison or in exile, and critics say that he has muzzled the media. Results from the Electoral Commission showed Solih, the joint compromise candidate of the weakened opposition, as the clear winner with 58.33% of the vote ahead of 41.7% for Yameen. State media, which before the election gave very little coverage to the opposition, also showed Solih declaring himself the winner. The US State Department on Monday called on Yameen to respect the will of the people. India was the first one to heartily congratulate Solih. On this edition of The Big Picture, we will take stock of the election in the Maldives. Joining me on the program today are Smita Sharma, Deputy Editor of the Tribune, Vivek Katju, former ambassador, Professor S.D. Muni, foreign affairs expert, and P.K. Ghosh, strategic expert. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Professor, I'd like to begin the program with you. Your thoughts on the election results in the Maldives.
Well, everybody says this has come as most unexpected one. To me, it was not unexpected one. I'll tell you what was unexpected. Because once the entire opposition got united, there was absolutely no scope for Yameen to win an honest vote. Now, the problem was on the honest vote, whether he will let it deliver or not. And this is where I think somewhere the Election Commission, despite the apparent cooperation which it was doing with the Yameen presidency, and the security forces perhaps have decided not to let him rig the elections. Otherwise, it would not have been possible. It is quite possible, because the previous changes in Maldives have taken place with the connivance of the security forces and with the connivance of the constitutional institutions like judiciary and election commission.
So I think... Were you surprised by the margin of victory, though?
No. See, the entire opposition is on one side. Even Yameen's own party, which half broke into his brother, is totally against him. His son and his daughter, whom he had ministers with him, were against him. Looking at this, and after all, the Maldivians, don't take them as complete innocent and foolish people. They had seen what he has been doing all along. So if a fair vote was to be, that's why India and international community, everybody was saying that we expect Yameen to be fair. Now, whether he tried, he did not want to be fair, perhaps. That's why on the pre-evening of the election, he got the opposition office raided, campaign office raided. So that apart. But internally, I think these critical institutions have decided not to let him play with the vote.
Ambassador Katju, what does this election result mean for the people of Maldives?
I think it's a resounding democratic victory for the people of Maldives. I entirely agree with what Professor is saying about the attitude and approach of the Maldivian institutions. But the fact remains that perhaps these institutions too had seen the popular resentment against Yameen. After all, there was a great undercurrent of opposition to Yameen and his policies. People were feeling extremely uneasy by his approach to China and his cocking a snook at India in a most provocative way. So the institutions also are, after all, part of the people. And if they see an overwhelming opposition to an incumbent, they also see the writing on the wall and they act accordingly, as they have done in this case.
Right. Smita Sharma, the Election Commission has not officially declared the result as of now. It's going to take 7 days to officially declare the result. Are we going to witness a smooth transition of power from Yameen to Solih?
Well, I do think that, you know, of course, there will be a lot of skepticism remaining given the past few months, the way things played out, and also the downward spiraling of not just the institutions, but also Maldives' own relations with India or with the Western powers, including America and European Union. But at the end of the day, President Yameen made a concession speech today. This came after, in fact, he met with the president-elect Ibrahim Solih. And in his speech, President Yameen, of course, tried, you know, pointing out to the stuff that he thinks that he has done towards the socio-economic development of Maldives. But the Foreign Ministry of Maldives has gone on the record now with the provisional election results. The presidential Twitter handle of Maldives, in fact, the presidency handle, that's gone ahead and tweeted that Ibrahim Solih, they've congratulated him officially. So I do think that at this point in time, while there will be some amount of skepticism, we will see this transition happening. We have seen a transition happen in 2008, in 2013. Circumstances were different. There were internal equations. But what is going to be crucial, because he's made it clear that he will be in office, President Yameen, until 17th of November. It's only after which power will be handed over to Mr. Solih. So in between, they'll have to work out a lot of things. He'll possibly have to figure out if there is any exit for him or not, which looks pretty difficult, pretty improbable. President Nasheed, the former president who has been living in exile in London, in Sri Lanka, he was in Colombo yesterday monitoring these elections and putting out his reactions. He has said that he would be attending the swearing-in ceremony of the new president, who happens to be his brother-in-law as well. So for President Nasheed to return to the island, all the pending cases against him, what's the future of that? These are things that are going to be work in progress over the next few weeks.
Indeed. These are things that are going to be work in progress. I think we'll talk about that as well. But before that, you know, PK Ghosh, where does this leave China, really? Because China has backed Yameen to the hilt. And what happens to Chinese-backed projects in the Maldives?
I think it is going to be a very interesting few months from now, and especially when the new president takes over. And I'm often reminded of how many of the other countries, especially if you take Malaysia, Mahathir Mohamed, you take even in Pakistan, where the new prime minister is having a rethought on the CPEC. And so many other countries are not really comfortable in the way that China is moving ahead in the entire region. So I think that there will obviously be a rethink on the way, as Nasheed has said, that the country has been sold out, Maldives has been sold out to the Chinese. And the fact that already about 70, he categorically mentioned, I think, 17 to 18 islands have already been given to them. So the fact is, I think there's going to be a realignment. There is going, as they have already said, that the India First policy may be renewed. And under Nasheed, with Nasheed guiding, of course, with the new president, I think there will be that tilt that was there towards the Chinese will be corrected. And I think that's a good news for India.
As far as China is concerned, Professor, is the Chinese BRI and also the Chinese influence in the region, you know, are we seeing a turn in that?
Well, I come to China in a minute. Before that, can I go back to the transition of power?
Right.
And therefore, I feel that, as she says rightly, that 17th November is still very far off, number one. Number two, this is a mumbo-jumbo opposition. Everybody has joined just to throw him out. Once he's thrown out, the question would be of sharing the cake, the power cake, who gets what. And I think the two very powerful, or three very powerful contenders, is Nasheed is one, Yameen's brother is another one, and one, I think, Adalat Party's chief, who has a very strong... And unless there is a harmony between them, how to take power and to distribute what to whom, and I have a feeling that Yameen may not still become hopeful of exploiting their contradictions and therefore getting an easy way out. He has to go out. There is no way. So much depends upon seeing how this opposition unity continues to be stable so far as transfer of power is concerned. Now, having said that, come back to China. I don't think it would be very easy to push the Chinese out. Chinese are not a pushover, number one. Look at some of the examples. Look at Sri Lanka. We had in India hope that once the Rajapakses go, the whole metrics of Sino-Sri Lankan relations would be redefined. It has not been redefined substantially in any way. In Nepal, one hydropower project was rejected. They have got back their one of the projects about it. In Pakistan, there is a debate about CPEC, right, no doubt about it, but still substantial projects remain there. And there is, in a way, a debate even within China whether most of the BRI investments would come back or not, and how they would be realized. So even the Chinese are struggling about how fast to go into these projects or to now put brakes and go very slowly. But have no mistake that the Chinese are not going to get out very easily. They have invested heavily in it. They have stakes which are very, very powerful because of Maldives' strategic location besides India and all that. So please sit down and watch, because I have a feeling that no matter, the pre-election statements mean nothing. There were a lot of pre-election statements in Sri Lanka in which they said that the Chinese are turning us into a colony. Who said that? Prime Minister Vikramasinghe said that, and the presidential candidate Sirisena said that. What happens later on? Therefore, please go cautiously on.
All right. That having been said, Ambassador, what should India's strategy be going forward?
Let me build upon what the professor has said. Quite clearly, part of the problem is that a new government inherits binding agreements which have been signed by a predecessor government. In Sri Lanka, this is what had happened. And once the Chinese tightened the new noose on the old agreements, or the inherited agreements, governments find themselves, as the Sri Lanka government found itself, in a great dilemma. Now, therefore, it's time now that India draws its red lines for the neighborhood. I think as a nation, beyond party politics, we have to now think strategically and sit down, our establishment, our political class, our security classes, and define and enunciate a clear neighborhood policy. Quite clearly, this neighborhood policy can't be ham-handed. It cannot be framed disregarding the normal aspirations of our neighbors. But there has to be a policy which puts India's security interests in a manner that are easily understood by everyone. We cannot allow the situation to drift because of the very reason that the professor has enunciated, that the Chinese are no pushover. And in the Maldives case, the Chinese earlier this year came out with statements which I construed as threatening us. Now, that situation cannot be allowed to continue. Therefore, it is need for a clear definition of a policy. If I'll just take one more minute, I'm reminded of the policy, for instance, which Gujral had enunciated, where he said that the neighbors would be getting access to the Indian market, but he drew a line at India's security interest that no one would be allowed to threaten India's security. Obviously, two decades have passed since the enunciation of the policy. The world has changed, but the essential principle of that policy admits of clarity and therefore of reiteration.
Right. You know, Smita Sharma, considering that this is an election year here in India, how much of importance do you think that we are going to give Maldives at this crucial time?
We have to. There's no option right now because, you know, you're kind of seeing an entire reset in the neighborhood. And if you look at the elections that have happened in South Asia, it's an interesting pattern. Pakistan, incumbent Nawaz Sharif lost his seat, Imran Khan came in. Bhutan, the ruling government, which India has very good ties with, it lost it's not even progressed to the final round of elections. Similarly, in Nepal, you've had KP Oli, of course, come and unseat Sher Bahadur Dioba. And now in Maldives, the incumbent Yameen government is gone, which, of course, suits India better. I think what India is doing at the moment, Frank, is remember the last few months, there's also been criticism, both, of course, from Maldivians and also within the opposition sections in Maldives, including President Nasheed, who thought that India should have perhaps done a little bit more in terms of criticizing what Yameen government was doing when it clamped down emergency on the island nation.
Played a more proactive role,
basically. They thought that perhaps US and EU were being more proactive, talking about sanctions compared to India, which simply said that there needs to be a restoration of democracy and the institutions. I have been speaking to diplomats in South Bloc, in the last 24 hours, who feel that on hindsight, it looks like waiting it out was a good strategy instead of trying to be pushy at this point in time, because people themselves have spoken. But they also feel that Solih is considered a stable, matured face. He's been a lawmaker for a long time. He's not held a ministerial portfolio, if I'm not mistaken. But as Professor Muni says, I tend to agree. India at this point in time is not believing that just because Solih comes in, just because the MDP comes into power, there's going to be an immediate recalibration vis-a-vis China. That will be unrealistic. That's not going to be pragmatic. I mean, China has loaned out $2 billion simply for the BRI project to Maldives. In Pakistan, we were talking about CPEC. Though that loan, the estimation has gone from, the investments have gone in from 46 to somewhere around $62 billion today. And Pakistan is even talking to Saudi Arabia to extend the CPEC project and make it a part of it. So China is going to stay there as far as its deep pockets are concerned, as far as Maldives needing money is concerned for resources. The airport projects, we saw that was a consortium project where other countries also came in. That's a reality that India has to deal with. But there are other issues of, you know, the kind of slides that we saw the last few months where Indian managers, doctors, nurses, they were not being issued visas by hotel owners or, in fact, employees in Maldives, the Indian population there. How do you go? Perhaps there will be a correction on those front for sure, because Solih is not considered somebody who is very outspoken or who speaks out of turn. He's normally considered respectable to all stakeholders, is able to carry forward with most of them and talk through them. So for India, they will have to be careful. And I think, as both Ambassador Katju and Professor Muni pointed out, that just simply saying that we have a neighborhood first policy will not resonate strongly enough unless you're also seen being sensitive to the concerns of these neighbors, because they do look up to you as a bigger player in the region. So be firm about your national security concerns, but be polite in conveying them through to the neighbors.
Right. You know, PK Ghosh, I'm going to go back to a point that Professor Muni was making about how, you know, it's a combined opposition that we are seeing in the Maldives. It's Yameen versus the rest, really, as far as this election is concerned. And we're now going to see several leaders who have been in exile probably go back to the Maldives. Is that something that China can use probably to drive a wedge, really, as far as these leaders are concerned? And is that something that should concern us?
I'll just go back to one point which Professor Muni made about the Chinese not being a pushover. As is well known, about 80% of the external debt of Maldives is actually in with the Chinese. And the Chinese have got this unique ability of putting these countries in debt and then taking over the strategic assets like they did in Sri Lanka and Hammam Kota, etc. And they got, even in Myanmar, they got the government to turn around because of the debt and other factors. So the ability of the Chinese to create a wedge is not unique. They can do it. Obviously, they will also try to gain as much influence with the new government. So now the question is, if they are going to look in the future, one is try and create that wedge between the new government, which is going to be formed. As Professor Muni mentioned, they have slightly diverse views. Or it is that try and influence the government which is going to come in to their benefit. Now, this aspect or this slight nuance is something that we'll have to wait and watch. So our strategy, which was mentioned by the ambassador, is extremely important. We know that the new government which is coming in is at least even-handed towards India. It's not going to at least try and turn too much towards the Chinese. We will have to play our cards in such a way to ensure that this aspect of the Chinese influence getting larger in Maldives is reduced. Our defense cooperation with the Maldivians has to increase, and it has got to go much beyond, you know, whatever we have got, including the two helicopters which are supposed to be given, etc., etc. So I'll not get into that. So we will have to, and we will have to sort of enhance our defense relationship and even people-to-people contacts with the Maldivians and try and see that we get a better hand. I mean, I think I'll leave it at that.
Right. Biggest challenges, Professor, as far as Solih and the other leaders in the Maldives are concerned, what do you think that they need to address first?
Well, I think to begin with, they have to correct the distortions in the institutional mechanism of Maldives which were introduced. The judiciary was totally, humiliated and used as a tool. Election commission, armed forces, all these democratic institutions will have to be set right. And that's why I think the president-elect had probably asked for the leaders who have been arrested and kept under prison unnecessarily to be released. I hope that until 17th November, this is what Yameen does. If he wants an easy exit, this would be one of the factors.
But is he going to get that easy exit is another question.
If he has accepted that what he did is wrong, then he will have to be far more softer rather than creating problems for them. So let us see how it happens. But if he has any lessons learned from this election, I think he should behave in this manner. May I introduce one more small point here, that while we are looking at China and India, don't forget the influence of US and UK, which is absolutely critical, and particularly Nasheed. Nasheed, all along his presidency, kept his close advisors from Britain, and he's far more closer to them. And I think one of the reasons why we played a pussyfooted in when he was being thrown about was because he was seen as closer to the US and UK, and probably he will give greater access to these countries. So it is time also for India not only to take its policy but to coordinate as to how other relevant stakeholders are working in the field. I'm not saying that we must surrender our options to them, but you have to be very careful in actually going ahead. So it is slow and steady would be better rather than jumping into some of the critical decisions.
Right. Ambassador, would India be making the mistake if we said that if we just take this result for granted and say that the Maldivians are now going to be with India and just play the waiting game?
I think we should never take any country for granted. Every country looks after its own interests. That is a given. The question is that we've got to help them define their interests in a manner that it coincides with ours. And that, Frank, I again come to this point, we cannot simply do if we let confusion prevail in the minds of the leaders in our neighborhood, including in Maldives, about what are India's red lines. I recollect that Rajapaksa used to tell people privately that he knows how far he can go playing India. And then he realized that that he was wrong. And that is, of course, in the absence of clearly defined policies. But Maldives, I think we have to be very careful. We shouldn't intervene in the personal equations of their leaders. And let us not forget that Yameen is a crafty person. He's given a lot of trouble to India in the past. It is a fact, and it is acknowledged that Yameen has this anti-India sentiment. People who have served there say this. And let us be careful, because while equations settle in the Maldives, Yameen in these 2 months will, I'm sure, be inclined to create trouble. He has to be, it will be for the Maldivian leadership now, the one that, the leadership that is coming in, the president-elect, they will have to find ways of restraining him by ensuring that there is at least a modicum of unity among them. It's not going to be a smooth and easy process, but I think at the end of the day, they will come to a modus vivendi among themselves.
Right. Smita Sharma, you know, what is it that is going to be extremely challenging for India going forward, and how do we deal with that?
Well, of course, as is mentioned, you know, how do you sort of ensure that the internal equation there is stable enough without being seen as interfering yourself? You know, be assertive with them without being pushy, trying to restore a semblance of normalcy in ties, people-to-people ties, more importantly. I remember Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who's actually toured the entire neighborhood except for Maldives, because he, in the past, he has cited the political turbulence within the small island nation for not having gone there. We'll have to wait and watch in case if he chooses to attend the swearing-in ceremony of President Solih, if that does take place anytime after 17th of November, or he does make a trip, because Indian elections, we are... At the moment, we think that it will happen sometime in May next year. There are a couple of months before that where he might still want to reach out to Maldives, be seen as traveling to that nation. But also at the same time, remember when you look at players like President Nasheed, you know, today one of the top diplomats in my conversation, he said that, look, as far as democracy in Maldives is concerned, Nasheed definitely has a guaranteed place because he was able to challenge 30 years of autocracy in that country when he won that election, the first democratically conducted election in 2008. But over the last few months, you've seen Nasheed every time he's come into India, either from London or from Colombo. He's also made quite a few provocative statements, including one where he thought that India should militarily invade Maldives, where the MEA had to, and of course it was backed by people like Subramaniam Swamy in the country, and MEA had to put out statements saying that these were personal views, these were not the official views. So I think also in terms of how President Nasheed's own equation with his brother-in-law, President Solih, plays out, India might not be wanting to be seen as investing completely in the Nasheed basket anymore and let the Maldivians take control of their own internal dynamics. But drawing those red lines as to, as Ambassador Katju said, as to, you know, beyond which is not going to be acceptable for India.
Right.
So these are things that South Bloc will have to work out on.
Indeed. The way forward for India-Maldives ties, PK Ghosh?
Absolutely. I think we will have to firstly draw a very fine line as to, you know, how much to get involved and how much not to get involved. It is going to be such a fine line, and there are going to be no definite answers in this. Because if something goes wrong, then, of course, everybody will turn around and say, we told you so, not to do this. And if something goes right, then, of course, the bouquets are always there. And it may not be so apparent also. So we will have to see. There have been a lot of criticism, as was mentioned, that why didn't India actually military intervene when, you know, when the emergency came around? And now we see that it was a good thing that we didn't
in hindsight.
So but at that time, I remember there were so many TV shows and others which kept saying that we should have gone ahead and, you know, tried to sort of negate the influence of the Chinese. So this is, again, in hindsight. So we will have to draw that fine line in which we will have to see that our interests are there. Maldives is a sovereign country. It has got its own internal dynamics,
right,
which, of course, will go on. I mean, I think the institutions are going to play a very important part in this till November. And so we are going to have our own elections next year. So the pot is going to keep on boiling, and we will have to see where we step and where we tread.
I'm out of time, but Ambassador, I can see you putting up your hand there very quickly. You and both Professor... Close the show for us. Go ahead, Ambassador.
One, I for one think that the Prime Minister should visit Maldives, but after the new government has settled in, I would imagine that sometime in December or January would be a good time to go, but he should certainly go. Second, it's better to allow locals equations to settle by themselves, and if you need, you can nudge them along. I don't think we should ever, you know, directly and aggressively intervene in the domestic processes of a neighboring country.
All right, thank you, Ambassador. Yes, Professor.
Just one sentence. Therefore, if we have to draw red lines, we better draw red lines for our policymakers what to do, what not to do.
All right. Statements to make or not to make.
Yeah, okay. Statements to make.
All right. On that note, then, I'll call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. That's it on this edition of The Big Picture. See you again next time.